If you have a modern TV, you've probably connected an HDMI cable. HDMI has become the preferred connection method for all things video in your home. Why is that? And what do all those acronyms mean? HDCP, ARC, eARC, CEC, VRR, ALLM, 4K 120, BLT. I must be hungry. Seriously though, we will make sense of the alphabet soup surrounding the ubiquitous video connection known as High Definition Multimedia Interface, or HDMI. In this video, we'll be referring to the capabilities of the most current and most common version of HDMI, HDMI 2.1, since it can do all the things. The HDMI cables and the connections look the same as they have since HDMI was released in the mid-2000s. But the capabilities of the cable have been getting regular upgrades, each with a new version number. Things like 4K video, high dynamic range, and eARC are examples of things that newer HDMI standards support that older standards do not. Most of the HDMI cables you can buy today are HDMI 2.1, and if you're in the market for a new HDMI cable, you'll definitely want to make sure it's a 2.1 cable. The newest cables are backwards compatible with older TVs and video sources that may use an older version of HDMI, such as 1.4 or 2.0. So you don't have to upgrade all of your components at the same time. But each time you do upgrade, you'll want to make sure it has the newest HDMI standard. You can tell an HDMI 2.1 cable as it will usually say Ultra High Speed HDMI Cable on the packaging. If it doesn't, you may be getting a cable that's an older version or is not certified as HDMI 2.1 or 2.1B. Let's dive into what all an HDMI cable does and make sense of those acronyms along the way. An HDMI cable carries video and audio information from one device to another, such as a Blu-ray player connected to a TV. It can also carry audio back the other direction. This is how a TV can send audio back down to a soundbar, and it allows connected devices to talk to each other digitally to simplify control of your system. ARC, or Audio Return Channel, is a convenience feature of HDMI, and it does exactly what the name implies. It passes digital audio back and forth between your TV and your receiver, powered speakers, or soundbar, with a single cable. Many of the videos you watch come from the TV's built-in streaming apps, or the over-the-air tuner for local TV stations. HDMI with ARC makes it possible for that audio to be sent out of the TV and into your audio system, so you aren't stuck listening to your TV's speakers. Yuck. Let me give you two examples of how this might be used. Let's say you're connecting your new soundbar to your TV. You would connect a single HDMI 2.1 cable to your soundbar on one end and to your TV's HDMI ARC or eARC output on the other end. If your TV has multiple HDMI inputs, one of them will be labeled ARC or eARC, and that's the one you want to use. Any external video sources, like a Blu-ray player or Apple TV, would need to connect to the other non-ARC HDMI inputs on your TV. The ARC-connected HDMI cable then carries all the audio signals from your TV's various HDMI inputs to your soundbar with a single cable. For the second example, let's say you have a TV, a home theater receiver, and three separate video sources, a Blu-ray player, Xbox, and a cable box. You'll connect all of your external video sources to your home theater receiver with HDMI 2.1 cables. It will take care of all of the audio for your surround sound system. You will also connect your home theater receiver to your TV with another HDMI 2.1 cable to send the video onto your TV in the highest resolution possible. But let's say you want to watch a program from your TV's built-in Netflix app and have the audio come out of your home theater receiver's speakers. That one cable that goes from your home theater receiver to your TV also carries the audio from your TV back down into your home theater receiver, so it can give you full surround sound. No additional cables needed. That's the magic of Audio Return Channel. I mentioned eARC before when we were talking about connections, so let's talk a little about the differences between ARC and eARC. eARC, or Enhanced Audio Return Channel, does the exact same thing as ARC, but it is capable of more bandwidth and higher bit rates, so it can carry more channels of uncompressed audio from your TV back down to your surround sound system, giving you better, more dynamic surround sound from the home theater system you installed. This is especially important when you have a Dolby Atmos or DTS:X surround system that incorporates height speakers like they do in good movie theaters. eARC is capable of sending an uncompressed surround sound signal to your soundbar or receiver, while the lower bandwidth ARC connection has to compress the signal somewhat. The difference in what you hear is subtle, but for the purists out there, eARC is what you want. eARC's higher bitrate also ensures that the audio and video are synchronized. This is super important for video game consoles that have a ton of video and audio information that absolutely must be synced up, or it could cost you dearly in the heat of the moment. It's a matter of video game life or death. Earlier, I mentioned that your HDMI connected components talk to each other. That's thanks to something called HDMI CEC, or Consumer Electronics Control. You may have already experienced the magic of CEC with your current setup. Here's an example of what it does. At my house, I have a Blu-ray player and an Apple TV connected via HDMI directly to my TV, and I have an HDMI cable that goes from my TV down to my soundbar. When I plop down on the couch, I simply grab my Apple TV remote and hit the power button. The Apple TV powers up, the TV turns on and goes to the correct input. The soundbar powers up and takes over audio duties from the TV. So when I hit the volume up or down button on the Apple TV remote, the Apple TV tells my TV to tell my soundbar to adjust the volume. Same for when I hit mute when the commercials come on. I could also use my TV remote to control my Apple TV. Those commands are sent from the TV to the Apple TV over the HDMI cable using HDMI CEC. Gone are the days of having to program a universal remote to allow me to control everything from one remote. And if I want to watch a Blu-ray disc, I pop a movie into the player, and when I do that, my TV switches to the Blu-ray player input automatically. And my TV remote now controls my Blu-ray player and my soundbar. It's so convenient. For all of this to work, it's critical to use the correct HDMI connections on your TV and other devices. Your TV may have 3 or 4 HDMI connections, but only one of them is labeled HDMI ARC or eARC. This is the connection to use to connect your sound system, and it's the same on the sound system. If it only has one HDMI connection, that's the ARC connection. But if it has multiple HDMIs, make sure to use the one labeled ARC or eARC to connect your soundbar, home theater receiver, or powered speakers to your TV. Your separate video sources like Blu-ray players, video game consoles, and cable boxes can be connected to the other HDMI inputs on your TV or your sound system. And with some TVs, you may need to go into the settings menu to enable ARC or eARC or CEC. Let's talk about some specific video game console HDMI issues you should be aware of. If you have a newer Xbox or PlayStation, you'll want to make sure to use HDMI 2.1 cables, and all your other gear should be compatible with HDMI 2.1 as well. With HDMI 2.1, you'll be able to take advantage of Auto Low Latency Mode, or ALLM. Through the magic of CEC, the video game console tells the TV to go into gaming mode with low latency to reduce delay from the controller to the screen. VRR, or variable refresh rate, is also important for video games, since the frame rate of a modern video game can change, and if your TV doesn't adjust accordingly, you could end up with screen tearing. All of the information about the game's variable refresh rate is sent to the TV using HDMI CEC, so the TV doesn't refresh out of sync with the game, keeping your video smooth. 4K 120 refers to a source, like a video game, in 4K resolution with a frame rate of 120 FPS, or frames per second. That's 120 4K images every second. That's a lot of data that has to make it from the console to the TV. And if you connect the console to your home theater receiver, your receiver has to be able to pass that resolution, along with all of the VRR and ALLM information, to the TV. To do this, everything must be HDMI 2.1, the TV, the receiver, and all the HDMI cables. What is HDCP and which version do you need? HDCP stands for High Bandwidth Digital Content Protection. Before a movie will play on a Blu-ray player or streaming box such as an Apple TV, the source component does a digital handshake with anything it's connected to, like your TV, soundbar, receiver, etc. This CEC handshake allows them to talk to each other. It also verifies that each component is up to date on its HDCP. If one piece of the chain is out of date on its HDCP, then the video may not play. This is to prevent people from pirating the movie. This all happens without you knowing it 99% of the time. The only time you'll run into issues with this is when you try to use a TV or home theater receiver that's more than a few years old. If the HDCP is too old, it may not let you play the movie. Oh, and here's a quick tip from our tech department. HDMI cables are hot swappable, meaning it's okay to unplug them and plug them back in even when the gear is powered on. Each time an HDMI cable is plugged in, it initiates a new handshake between the connected components. Our techs really know their stuff. You can call them 7 days a week with questions if you buy your gear from Crutchfield. You will see some HDMI cables are passive and some are active. Active HDMI cables use added power to strengthen the signal for a longer run of cable. Some get their power directly through the HDMI connection, and some use a separate power wire that connects to the ends of the HDMI cable, usually in the form of a USB connection. Many devices with HDMI connections also have USB connections that can be used to power your active cable. For longer runs, anything more than a few meters, you should use an active HDMI cable. If your HDMI cable is less than 3 meters long, you can use passive HDMI cables. Lastly, some HDMI cables are directional. It matters which end you plug into your source and which end goes to your TV or projector. There's arrows on each end of the cable to guide you. It's really important to get this right, especially when you are running your HDMI cable through the wall. I hope this helps make sense of all the acronyms associated with HDMI cables. If you have any questions about this or anything else, reach out. We can help. And thanks for watching.